What up, everybody? This is Jason Lee from Hollywood Unlocked Uncensored.
And Melissa Ford, a.k.a. The Curve Queen.
Your boy Spank, tall, dark, and not handsome, but funny.
and we have a guest. Melissa, set it up. You invited the wonderful.
Yeah, Laz Alonso.
Yo.
Very good friend of mine. Been friends for years and a fan of the show.
Okay. Big fan of the show.
So yeah. I've had Laz's number for a long time, but I get really uncomfortable trying to become friends with people in Hollywood because I'm so fucking reckless. So I really
and they
don't
are
know
scared of you.
What? I don't understand that.
I don't understand it either.
Bro, let me tell you something. Once I was even offered the opportunity to come on the show for fear that my picture might end up in this seat, I said, let's go.
So let's just assume that he's seen the Little Mama interview.
Listen, so what did you think of our Little Mama interview?
I was very intrigued by Little Mama, what she had to say. She was very, very interesting. I learned so much more about her. Like, I feel like I really know her just that much better now.
Yeah, she had a lot to talk about, especially.
And
her
she was black
practice.
And white with it. She was black and white.
She got a little tight lipped during the end, but
she definitely was
see through.
She did.
Well, we're glad that you could physically make it.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, because my car showed up.
Black car?
It was a black I'm not car. Throwing any shade, by
it was
the way.
A black
it's
car.
Just funny. It was funny.
Wait, when Melissa funny. Told me, she said, Laz Alonso is going to come on the show. I'm like, yeah, but Laz is so, he's in the white movies. He's like he's like real Hollywood. There's no
safe,
way.
He's safe.
There's no way he would come on here. She was like, Laz is reckless as fuck. He's going to be fun.
Yes.
That's why I'm trying to be sober.
Yeah.
So. Oh, no. Well, we wanted a drink earlier, but they wanted me to put my drink on the floor and drink out the floor.
You know what? Speaking of drinks,
yes,
I come bearing gifts.
Did you?
I come bearing
we got gifts.
Oh,
too.
We've got gifts.
I wanted
for you
to
too.
Bring to Hollywood
oh,
Unlocked.
Shit.
I've never seen that before.
Exactly. Wow. Exactly. It's a new partnership that I have with Remy Martin.
Okay. Not only did he drive himself, he brought booze. This is a friend for life.
That's how I do. That's how. Don't all the guests bring something?
No, they don't.
They don't.
No, they bring themselves, which is good enough for us.
Yeah. What kind of guests y'all have on this show?
I mean,
not ones that know us as intimately as you do. Remy Martin.
Yeah. Just to tell you a little bit about that. That comes from the house of Remy. It's called an Eau de Vie.
Okay.
It's a premium white spirit. If you like, you know, your vodkas or, you know, your white spirits, that's an upscale, sophisticated alternative to that.
Oh, wow.
And it mixes with anything.
So when we drink this, Melissa, it'll be the only time we're sophisticated.
Let me tell you something about Laz.
You'll be ratchet. You'll be ratchet.
We'll be ratchet right after.
Let me tell you something about Laz, okay? His nickname should be the refined ruffian. You know what I'm saying?
I like that.
Yeah, exactly. Like that. Because literally, he's like a Neanderthal. He will club you over the head and drag you back to his cave.
He's from D.C.
What's my man. That's how we do.
I always tell
people, like, in D.C.,
refined.
Like, killers are clean cut. Like, you can't.
They're just not like the Bloods and Crips we know from California.
Nah. Like, you got to be scared of the light-skinned cats in D.C. They're the first ones that'll pop.
Shit, if you had too much of this Remy, you better be scared of me.
Hey, no, Spank, for real,
you
for real.
No, bro.
Yeah, okay, so as a refined ruffian, so you and Melissa have been friends for a long time. You've never tried to fuck?
Wow, Jason, Jesus Christ.
You know we say that to single men.
Laz, hold on one second. I wasn't even prepared for that one.
That came out of nowhere.
But if you have, I need the details.
No.
I ain't going to say that there wasn't a point in time that I wasn't attracted to her. Because I think you'd be, I mean, who wouldn't be?
Me.
You know what I'm saying? Well,
just me.
Well, you know.
Right.
Obvious reasons.
This man.
Last don't know what to say. Well.
Yeah, no. Yeah. I mean, I'm going to let that go. I'm going to let that play out. I'm going to let it go ahead and die down. And then I'm going to jump back in once it's safe. You know what I'm saying? Nah, but I mean, you know, we became friends right around BET, right?
Yeah,
it was right around the BET times. And then, you know, like, there's one thing that I don't do, and that's, you know, shit where I eat.
Mm.
So I don't like to bring personal situations on set. Because that never ends up
so
good.
That's why there's, like, really almost no rumors about you dating your fellow actresses and whatnot.
Yeah,
like,
I keep it clean.
Well, speaking of your fellow actresses, we had Megan Good here.
Megan, yeah.
She, according to Melissa, has worked with you in a lot of projects.
We did a TV show together.
Deception.
Mm-hmm. We did Jump in the Broom,
mm-hmm.
Stomp the Yard. Yeah. So we've worked several times together. And, you know, I mean, Megan, she's a beast.
Yeah.
She said she gave you some advice, you know, like when you were like, I'm really trying to break into acting and, you know, whatever it was that she said. 4 years later, she was just like, now he's like everywhere. He's like getting every single job.
Yeah. Megan is like that supportive person that you can always count on to give you like words of advice.
Yeah.
Like, I've never seen her or heard her be negative.
I said the same thing. I said that.
That's
okay.
True.
Speaking of never shitting where you eat, we had Tank on the show who said he likes to get his booty eaten. What do you think about that?
You know, to each his own. That's not a personal favorite of mine.
That's Latin. Not your thing.
That's not a personal favorite of mine.
Like, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. You know, I like, you know, pleasure from the front side of my body.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like, this is, I'm good in the front. You know, the back is like.
There's no looking back.
No. It's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like all chest day. No back day. You know what I mean? Okay. Okay, no squats.
Perfect. Appreciate you bringing us a gift up. I believe we have a gift for you.
Yes, we do.
We actually, just before we set that up, I was actually going to have this room filled with women who were dressed regular, and then they were just going to start stripping and be. It was going to be fucking crazy, but they're all in Vegas with Floyd. Shout out to our friends.
Floyd, come on, shout out man. To
Floyd. Yes.
Floyd, fuck that up, but we have a gift for you.
We do. So, you know, you're Cuban, and so, you know, you're.
Don't make this a blanket Cuban jiggling. Thing.
I hear maracas.
He's a fucking hot tamale. Oh, he really is. Okay. So,
just hand him the bag.
Yeah. Okay. Here you go.
We're handing a blue bag.
We're handing a blue bag. Right, it's Tiffany blue.
I know. I peeped. It's a Tiffany bag.
But it ain't no Tiffany.
But like when your birthday, what kind of bag did you give him? It was a Gucci bag with non-Gucci items.
Yeah. Hell yeah. She gave me a Gucci bag. She gave me a Gucci bag with a facial regimen.
It's like the Kiehl's, right? The Kiehl's.
Which is good stuff. Thank you.
No, she gave you good stuff, actually.
Thank you. All right, so describe this gift for the people who are listening.
Oh, Lord.
No, he needs to describe it.
Oh, my God. No. Oh, come on, man.
It's edible. It's edible. So just for everybody who's just listening, we got Laz an edible ball gag.
Wow.
With a mask included.
But why?
We just figured that you might have some fun with that.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, see, I just moved here. I guess welcome to LA, huh?
Where do I go with this?
Do those come with handcuffs?
Can you show me how to use it?
Oh, you're funny.
I mean, listen.
You're funny.
You know.
Well, once it's in my mouth, then it just can't be put in anybody else's.
Hey,
oh, my God. I set myself up for that one.
That's not what he said.
Hey, don't start no won't be none, man.
That's not what he said.
Hey, Melissa, we've been friends for a long time, but if you switch gears on this thing, I'm going all in, son.
Oh my God!
That's this show will change real quick.
As long as you understand, the don't camera give me the green will keep light. On rolling.
Don't give me the green light.
It's really hot in here right now, Lisa.
Shout out to Nelly.
Melissa's good at like shutting stuff down. Though.
She's
like,
the curve queen.
She's the curve queen.
She is.
Like every now and then, she'll say some shit that like gets you like, oh, was that? What? And then you might think of even like stepping out of line, and then boom! It's like.
I told
what
her,
the
I
hell
said,
just happened?
I told her God gave the vagina to the right person because it could be the 405 over there if she was with the right one.
Yeah, it's the 405.
No. It's a closed down exit over here.
Well, the 405, there's no, it's slow. It's
standing
traffic.
Still.
It's nothing's moving.
Yeah, well, no, this cobwebs over here. We've had a conversation about this at least, you know, 100 times.
We talk about the cobwebs on the radio, but we know real life is popping.
Oh, God,
Jesus. Something going on.
It's popping. It's popping.
Come on.
Something's popping. She ain't sitting over there, Sister Mary Claire,
She's blowing too much for it not to be popping.
Two things. Cocoa butter. And you know I'm obsessed with that shit. Right. And Hitachi. Okay? Sharper image, motherfuckers.
Oh, snap.
Yes.
I don't know nothing about your Hitachi.
You need a Duracell deal.
So you used to date.
I need to plug it in because I'm tired of them burning out.
So Laz used to date one of my former friends, Bria Miles.
Former?
Yeah, I took her on a trip to Miami. Floyd sent a jet for us. We went to Miami. To have a good time, and she, like little mama, had a long list of demands. And I mean, don't want to get too into it because she's real active on Twitter. I don't need my Twitter numbers to go up. But anyway, why did you guys break up?
You know, I believe that there are people that come into your life for a season, for a reason, or for a lifetime.
Mm.
And I think that at the time when we dated, it was for a season.
Mm-hmm.
It was for a season. You know, it's funny how we met. At the time, she had just gone through a breakup that really had, like, you know, fucked her up. And she was, like, very
open.
I mean, she was open and she was vulnerable, you know. And at the time, I had just gone through a major issue with my back. Like, I had thrown out my back and I couldn't do nothing. Like, I couldn't even walk my dog, you know. So we just happened to just, like, and we were friends. We had been friends for years.
Mm-hmm.
But we had just happened to reconnect. Just like on some, hey, what's up? What's going on? Nothing. Like laying on the couch, I can't walk. And she was basically holed up in her apartment for a few days, just kind of like sad. So I was like, yo, just come hang out and help me out. Cause like, I need somebody to like kind of nurse me back to health,
mm-hmm.
you know? And she needed her own emotional nursing. So it was kind of like this situation where two people that probably would have never ended up dating, mm-hmm. because we were both in a very broken state at that point in our lives. we ended up like spending like a whole week, a platonic week, because I couldn't do nothing even if I wanted to do something. Like my shit was like, I was laid out.
Yeah.
Sheesh. You know, but it was like shit, a platonic.
My bad, girl. You can still get some head.
Yeah, Laz.
Let it calm down.
I'm sitting up here trying to make this thing sound
all diplomatic
beautiful and
shit.
And this motherfucker is just.
I was waiting for him to say. Yeah. I was waiting for him to say he was doing target practice.
but at the time it was like, she needed somebody to talk to, and she needed like a male energy that was gonna like basically just basically be there. And at the time, I needed somebody to kind of like take care of me, you know, and basically get me back on my feet again. And that was the role that we played for each other for a good like, you know, couple months until finally, you know, we were on our feet and it was like, oh snap, we're dating. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It just kind of happened very organically. And I think that, you know, over time, you know, once that kind of ran its course, it was time for us to just be like, all right, you know what? Like, you know, for one reason or another, God made us cross paths. We helped each other out. And now it's time for
she
you
thought,
to do your
she
thing.
She thought y'all were going
to
get married.
She did?
She did. Mm. She thought she was going to put a ring on that.
She's nice. I like Brim.
See, I wasn't privy to those conversations.
She thought you were going to put a ring on it.
Right? I didn't understand it.
I know you didn't.
But the relationship?
And you, yes. I don't even
think you were speaking to me at that time.
Wow.
Well, not because of that.
No, not because of that, but you were in New York, I was here, but at the time, like, I don't think you approved.
Mm. Really?
Did I go so far
as to say that?
Did you not approve?
You never said that. You never said that. You just didn't really give me a warm vibe.
Put the camera on Melissa. Did you not approve?
It wasn't a warm vibe.
Let me put it like this. Who was the guy that she broke up with, that horrible breakup?
I don't know.
I think I know.
Who?
My ex.
Really?
Oh, okay.
Not Flo Rida.
Really?
I don't remember. I don't know the timing of things. Shit.
No.
I had too much Remy.
No.
Yeah, those were the days.
So, okay. You know what? If it was a non-approval vibe, it's simply just because I'm so close to Laz.
As a friend, yeah.
And right. I'm so protective of my friends that...
Did you ever think in life that you guys would interview a real life avatar?
No.
This motherfucker was in one of the biggest movies ever. The biggest movie ever.
Here's the kicker. He never told me.
Would you have ever known? The motherfucker was blue the whole film.
No. I'm watching the movie and listening to his voice. And you had some kind of like, I don't know, alien accent or some shit like that going on.
He's an actor.
There was something there. I was like, that's fucking Laz. Mm. I knew it. And I called him up. I was like, why the fuck didn't you tell me? He was just like, no reason.
You know,
given.
I'm gonna be honest with you. Like, I come from like a school of thought where your work speaks for you.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Like, not who you date, not who you have sex with. Like, I don't.
What
put
that IMDb
that shit
look
there.
Like?
That IMDb is popping.
You know what I'm saying? In terms of the work.
Right. But that's exactly it.
But I'm pumped.
You know. but like that's exactly it. Like that's 100% what that IMDb look like. Like I don't feel like. If my work doesn't speak for me, then I need to shut the fuck up and work harder.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That was a big film. I love that film. I actually watched the entire thing like 3 times. That's a long time for that long. That's
a
long ass movie.
That's a lot.
Zoe was sexy as a blue avatar. She was sexy to me. She was sexy. You want sexy to y'all as the blue?
Zoe's sexy. Yeah,
she's sexy.
So being in Hollywood, working with all these beautiful women, it's not an issue I would have. But for you, have you ever? Is there any woman in Hollywood that you've slept with that we don't know? I'm sure there has to be.
Of course.
But you're not going to tell us.
Hell nah.
Let me tell you who he had a really big crush on.
Who?
Like he literally had to call me and be like, yo.
I'm afraid of this one.
Who?
Angela Bassett.
Oh yeah.
So you never slept with, we have the same birthday.
No, she's married. Respect, very married. Yeah. Like married and in love.
Right.
Married.
Right.
She hasn't been married forever.
No, but she was married.
When we worked together, she was married and she still is. And
yeah, Courtney
I have a lot
B.
of respect for
she's
her.
She's my favorite actress.
But what I was telling Melissa was like,
her body puts 20-year-olds to shame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because like I feel like Melissa's body puts 20-year-olds to shame.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and it will continue to do that. For a very long time.
Because midnight yoga and all that
midnight
extra stuff, right?
Candlelight yoga. Mm-hmm.
That's so what it is.
So if
the power of the moon.
So if Angela would have said, okay, Laz, you can get it, but nobody will know.
Nah, man. Nah.
Really?
Nah.
Damn.
That's bullshit, Laz.
Listen,
okay? That's bullshit.
Put it like this. While we were working together, no. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Like, I have a strict policy. When I work with you,
that is it is not going down.
But at the rap party.
Little ting ting in the bathroom.
Nah, man.
Okay, so
I know her husband. Like, that kills everything.
Okay, damn. So who do you have a crush on in Hollywood?
I don't have a crush on anybody right now.
You really don't.
No, I promise you. Like, it bothers me a little bit.
Why?
Just because,
not even Rihanna?
Like,
not even Rihanna?
Rihanna's hot. Rihanna, like, doesn't she have something going on with Drake? Like, isn't that?
Who knows?
I'm trying to figure it out too.
It looks like it.
Yeah.
It's Thursday.
I'm so back.
Rihanna could definitely, though, she could definitely be up there.
Yeah, she's nice. Yeah. She actually looked me in my eyes and said, "You was very funny tonight at a show." And we locked eyes. We had a moment. So I'll let y'all know that.
I don't
know
if y'all survived. She's
actually really nice too. Yeah, she's super cool and down to earth.
She is.
Can I reveal a real Rihanna story real quick? So I heard Rihanna was going to be at the Roc Nation brunch, and I wasn't on the list, and I didn't know how to get on the list. I'm going to tell y'all what I did.
Oh, Lord.
I went and got my boy, and we pulled up in an Escalade. We rented a black Escalade, by the way. Okay. We pulled up. I said, "Yeah, I'm the editor-in-chief of Vibe magazine, and this is so-and-so from Interscope Records. We're on the list." The lady was like, "Sorry, you're not on the list. I feel really bad." So she said, and I knew somebody who worked at Roc Nation. I was like, I'm going to go meet Rihanna. So Kelly Cornett works there because she's a coordinator, whatever she was. So I knew who her name. I said, "Well, Kelly Cornett put us on the list." She goes, "If Kelly emails you to let you up, and you show me that, I'll let you in." I went around the corner and made a fake Kelly Cornett email address. I emailed myself. Wow. "Kelly, there's a problem. I can't believe I'm not on the list." I replied to myself.
Wow.
And then showed her, and I got in. So I walk up to Rihanna. I'm waiting, right? I see Rihanna walk in the room.
He's
so I wait.
So resourceful.
It was me and Don Benjamin, by the way. Don Benjamin was the artist from Interscope. Anyway, shout out to him. So he's like, "Motherfucker, you are a nut." So I'm in there like, "You got to act real normal. Like, we belong here. Like, we waving them up. Hey, Miguel, you know." So finally, Rihanna walks up. I'm like, "You have beautiful eyes." And then I asked her to follow me on Twitter. It was the dumbest shit. Like, out of everything I could have said, nonetheless, she said she was going to follow me and didn't. So, Reed, that was fucked up. But I did that by any means necessary.
She might be following
Hollywood
you now.
Unlocked days.
This was before Hollywood Unlocked days. This was like, literally, I just want to go see Rihanna because she's gorgeous.
Mm. Oh. So, you can't get away with that now.
Then Beyonce walked in the room and nobody mattered.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it was sad.
And Beyonce is his end all be all. He would push me right out the way if she was coming.
I would put you out the car to give her a ride.
Be nice, though.
Yeah.
So you were in the film Just Right.
Yes.
You know, Queen Latifah is my girl. How was working with her in common?
It was dope. I mean, I think they're both just like old hip hop. So they're from a different school. Like,
yeah.
They're just regular people.
Yeah.
They're not on that Hollywood.
They're not
shit.
On no superstar shit.
Yeah. They're just like cool, slap hands, you know, whatever. It's I like working with people like that.
Wait, Paula Patton was in that as well.
Paula Patton.
And she was in Jumping in
the Broom. That was before Jumping the Broom. Yeah. That's actually the set where I met Paula.
Was on
Just Right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Will LeMay was in Jumping the Broom.
Was he?
Yeah, by the way, I got Will LeMay in that movie.
Oh, matter of fact, yeah, he was in the very beginning.
Yeah, yeah. He didn't thank me, and I definitely didn't get a commission. So payback, or in the earlier
payback's
segment.
A bitch, and yeah. Then here earlier was the name. Sorry.
Call, that was
my
call.
Bad, my bad, sorry.
God, see
bad.
How small this community is? We got to be
small.
Careful.
Ridiculously small.
I can't afford security right now. Nelly's already tried to beat me up.
What?
Fucking people. I mean, I don't know what's going on. I'm a nice guy.
What'd you do to Nelly?
No, wait. So you watched the Floyd interviews, right? Well, there was like five of them, so I'm not sure if you caught all five. But in one of the, it was like with the first
I
one.
I just asked him if I asked Floyd, I couldn't think of an opening question. Sometimes I just throw out whatever I'm thinking. And I asked him if he believed Nelly owed him a refund for all the work he put into his girlfriend. And I thought it was funny, but apparently Nelly did not. He almost hit me. Had me afraid for my life,
wow.
For the record.
Jeez.
But nonetheless, I still listen to his album.
That's good.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. I'm playing. Well, he ain't got one. Y'all missing all my jokes. Anyway. Okay, so.
I caught that one.
Okay, so what are you working on now? I'm sure you're busy.
Yeah, I'm doing a lot. Well, as far as acting is concerned, I'm doing a lot of reading right now.
But
my show.
How's the show going? The Mysteries of Laura.
Mysteries of Laura ended in May.
It's
for
so,
good.
For
we're
good?
Done for good. Yeah,
no
we're
way.
Done for good. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. We're
did
done
it
for good.
Finish. Like, did they know it was going to end?
You know, we didn't. Every season on that show, for some reason. We were always what if, like it could come back, it might not. It was always on the bubble.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think that it was because NBC didn't really know if it was a comedy or if it was a drama.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was kind of in between. It was a hybrid.
Mm-hmm.
And so
but NBC
know,
loves them some Laz.
Yeah, no, they've shown a lot of love.
Yeah,
NBC's really, shown a lot of love.
Yeah.
ABC's shown a lot of love.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been very blessed. You know, like I've had a very like strong career.
A&E breakout pains. Straight,
yeah,
A&E breakout pains. From a BET host. You know, a lot of BET hosts don't, you know, it'd be
nothing happened.
Terrence J made it, too.
Oh, yeah, TJ.
Roxy's still, you know, doing her thing. Tigger's doing
his
thing.
Bow Wow just retired. You know, Bow Wow retired.
From rap.
Y'all are being messy. I'm just reporting the news.
Oh, my goodness.
Bow Wow has retired from rap, and he's acting now. Shad Moss. Shout out to Shad.
Shout out to Shad.
Actually, he's got a show coming out, right? I think he's doing a kind of lip sync type, you know, like
a talk show. He's doing a talk show. Yeah, he's going to be a talk show.
A game show of some sort.
Interesting. Yeah, that should be interesting. We're going to follow that.
So, speaking of talk shows, have you had a chance to watch Amber Rose's talk show?
I only caught a little bit of it.
Okay. And
but you've seen all our shows, so clearly we're keeping you entertained. What do you think of Amber's show?
I mean, the only thing that I saw, she was just basically talking about sex.
Right.
A lot. Right. No, which is cool, but I don't know. I haven't watched more than one episode, so I don't know if that's all she talks about.
Mm-hmm. But it's pretty much.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I don't know how sustainable that is.
She's a champion for women. She's encouraging women to take back their slut. What is it, slut walk thing?
Oh, slut walk, yeah. I think if anybody just has a voice, like as long as you have your own voice, mm-hmm. then it can work. Because there's going to be somebody that resonates with it. So as long as it did feel authentic. Like when I heard her, she didn't sound uncomfortable. She didn't sound rehearsed or like she was reading a teleprompter. It sounded like they were just letting her do her.
Mm.
You know, and it
sounded
real.
They should probably start writing that show then.
Oh, Lord.
That shit boring. But, okay. So, are you following the current politics with the current presidential?
100%.
Between Hillary 100%. And... What's his name? What's the fuck boy's name?
Trump.
Donald Trump.
Yeah.
What do you think of that?
He's a total geek. Like, undercover nerd.
Yeah, I'm an undercover nerd. Yeah.
What do you think about that? What do you think about Donald Trump and his whole... messaging,
you know, I think that it's very revealing, you know, because it's showing us what the last 8 years of fear of the black man and fear of now a woman is doing to a very, very right wing set of ideals that is seeing themselves become irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even when it comes to, you know, legitimizing gay marriage,
mm-hmm.
and that's something that breaks down everything that they stood against.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
they're trying to take back women's right to abortion. I mean, mm-hmm. they're trying to take us back to the 50s and this whole Make America Great Again. And it's an awful
campaign.
Yeah, I mean, it really shows where their mind is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so,
and it's scary that it could actually be in the running. It could get in office.
He can get in office. That's why I tell people it's not written in stone. Like Hillary's not gonna win, and everybody's like hating on Hillary. But you know, we have been picking the lesser of two evils in every single election since the beginning of this country.
That's what I keep saying.
You know what I'm saying? And right now, Trump is talking all this stuff to black people about, you know, what do you have to lose? You're in poverty. You're doing this. Well, guess what? We have to lose. We have 51 years. Of
progress
to lose, because let's keep in mind that until 1965, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, black people really weren't completely legitimized in this country, and we're still fighting for legitimacy. But in the last 51 years, more black millionaires and some billionaires have happened in just a generation of our parents.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we have 51 years of progress. Can you imagine everything that we've accomplished in the last 51 years? 51 years from now
would be crazy to go away.
And exactly. We're only 11% of the population.
Right.
You know, so we have a lot to lose. We have a lot to lose. And then comparing black people to the most porous situations is ridiculous.
You know what I love about this show? Mm-hmm. We can have this conversation and ball gags in the same episode.
Right. We still got ball gags.
I think we should send this to Donald Trump.
We should send it to Donald Trump.
Yes, he absolutely should have a ball gag. So Spank and I were talking earlier, and, you know, just about, because you keep saying we, you know, and it's like your kind of connection with the black community, but you're Cuban. Like,
I'm black first.
Yeah.
I'm black first.
So how you identify yourself.
But are you full Cuban?
I'm full Cuban.
I thought he was black too.
I know,
but I am black.
No,
here's
the, everyone thinks that you are like okay, the black lineage.
Let me explain how it works. You know, this is another thing that I feel like we as black people get caught up in that
semantics
that separates us as opposed to uniting us. We get caught up in where the ship dropped us off versus where the ship picked us up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? We all come from the same root. It's just a tree with different branches. The same boat. that picked up your ancestors, picked up my ancestors. Only they dropped yours off here. They made a pit stop in the Caribbean and dropped mine off. Mm-hmm. But my ancestors still dealt with slavery, mm-hmm. you know, still dealt with being, you know, having their family and their lives ripped from them and having to come back from colonialism and slavery. Mm-hmm. You know, so, and it's not just African-Americans, it's Afro-Cubans, it's Afro-Dominicans, it's Afro-Puerto Ricans. Like, all these people got to get out of their colonialized minds and stop thinking, oh, I'm not this, I'm this. Okay, yeah, you can be Latin, but you're black first.
And the separatism that takes us apart when we all have the same struggle. We all experience 100%, the same struggle.
Because when I walk into a room, they ain't thinking, oh, we going to give him a pass because he's Latin. Cuban, yeah. Or if a cop pulls me over, he's not like, oh, okay, I'm not going to shoot him or I'm not going to beat his ass because he's Cuban. Mm-hmm. No, I'm black. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I'm dealing with the same struggle. So we all gotta unite and fight for the struggle together because we're all dealing with the exact same struggle.
So Omarosa has been tabbed by Donald Trump to be the director of African American outreach to bring more black people, more Afro Americans, more people of color into his campaign. What do you think about that?
I don't think it's working.
Right.
I mean, he's got less than 1%. You know, I just don't like it when I hear people say, well, you know, he does have a point. I mean, the Democratic Party, you know, has, you know, put us on welfare. And you know, at the end of the day, you got to look at historical fact. You know, what has the Republican Party done for you mm-hmm. besides talk?
Right.
You know, so if you say, well, one is giving me welfare and the other one, you know, they're saying, why not vote for them? Well, guess what? If I was drowning in the ocean, I'm going to vote for the one that's threw a life vest out. You know, now once I cast the life vest, it's up to me to swim to the boat and get up on the boat.
Right.
You know, but there's one that's done something and there's one that hasn't done anything.
Right. And it's crazy obvious. That they're even in the running.
Yeah.
It's insane.
So for the people on the radio that can't see, Laz repositioned his mic because it was just a little too inappropriate. you know, there's some about being in the proximity of being around me that make people, I don't know, he's not uncomfortable because clearly he's secure in who he is, but I have nothing to do with the arrangement of mics in this room.
Wait, does it point down? Or does it point up? Depends. Like, which one is more comfortable
your
for
mic,
you?
Your mic points straight.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what direction it points.
See, now y'all got me like this.
I know, right? There's no way out. It's just jabbing me in the side of my head.
No pun intended. Okay. So have you ever had sex with a fan?
No.
Never?
No. Nah.
Would you ever have sex with a fan?
Hold on. Back up.
Because that would be the new fan club.
Put it like this.
Back up. Because you never know who your fans are. Sometimes,
true. That's what I was going to say.
Sometimes you find out after the
fact.
And it could be somebody who is clearly in entertainment.
But what I mean, I'm not talking about did you run into Eva Marcel who liked his last project and did they go fuck. I'm saying, did you ever fuck Eva?
No.
Oh, I don't. I'm just...
She doesn't have enough in the back.
You said it.
No, it's true. She doesn't. See the size of Bria's ass? Jesus Christ.
Of course I did. Okay, yeah. So.
That's a hard one to compare to, though. Like,
yeah, that's like a.
Laz likes ass.
If it had to be Bria's size, then I would never be with anybody. Because that's.
Bria does have an ass to herself.
That's like.
Shout out to Bria.
It's a whole new world.
I love
it. Whole universe.
It is.
Why did I just hear that song singing in my head? I mean, like a fan, that just, you know, like you see a fan.
Nah, you know why? Because like, you know, you can tell when somebody doesn't see you. Like when you meet a fan and they're not looking at you, they're looking at their idea of what they've created you to be. Mm-hmm. I'd rather let them have that. Yeah. Like let them have their fantasy. I don't want to ruin it by then them really meeting who I might really be. And it completely destroys their idea of what they've created. So it's like.
So you like being a fantasy figure?
I just think.
He's an avatar.
I just think people like, they fall in love with characters.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So they fall in love with the character from Jumping the Broom, or they fall in love with the character from this other film.
Yeah.
And that's what they're attached to.
What character have you played that gets you the most, like, not play, but just.
Pussy.
The invitation of pussy. Like, which character have you played that women are just like, oh my God.
I think when I was filming Fast and Furious.
I already said the bad guy.
Yeah.
I already said the bad guy.
I got the most hate from cops. Like, I was getting pulled over at least 3-4 times a week.
Really?
And would they bring up the film?
No, it was just because the way I looked, because I had the mohawk and I had the lines and scars and tattoos and, you know, and I was big.
I mean, like, fuck.
What's she saying?
Is it sexy?
The bad guy role.
Now we know what you like.
Melissa, you got a lot of ass.
Gorilla.
You got a lot of ass.
Oh, my God.
I can see you guys together.
Yes, we would make a very good looking couple.
We will, right?
We're not blind.
You don't have any kids,
Jason,
right?
Jason, hook that up.
Oh, it's not a problem.
He regularly brokers Run my that. Vagina.
I just need a commission.
You were on Wall Street at one point, so this was, is a better right? salesman than I've ever met, and I've lived on Wall Street.
Okay, so, wait, I was going to ask another reckless ass question. Well, go ahead.
But Fast and Furious, that's the one that got you the most problems and the most shit.
Yeah, like, I mean, it was crazy. It was like, this is what women like all this clean cut shit and, you know, goatee and all that. Women don't like that. Women like a dude that looks like he just got out of jail, you know, and did some serious hard time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do look like I just did 5 to 10. I'm just letting y'all know that. I do like I did 5 to 10. That's all. Just 5 to 10.
During that time, boy, it was like, I mean, and all kinds of women too. Like, it didn't matter.
So are you like a sex on the first date kind of guy, or are you you'll take your time? Like, if you meet a girl, y'all go on a date and you like her and she wants to have sex, or she's down to have sex first night, would you do it?
Do you court?
I you know, I just kind of go with whatever feels right and whatever feels natural. You know what I'm saying? I don't push it. Like, I think when I was younger, I pushed it. Mm-hmm. But like now it's just more like whatever feels right. You know, I just don't like what I don't like is aggressive women. I don't like women that are just too like.
Because you're a total alpha. Like, I was scared to say that.
I'm a little scared of aggressive women, too.
Don't
but I was
be afraid.
To say
I just don't like it.
I'm sitting next to two very confident men, confident in your heterosexuality, you know, so go ahead.
No, babe. I was scared to say that before. I was scared. I'm scared of an aggressive, just, hey, what's up?
Oh, yeah. Have you ever had an experience that you want to talk about?
I don't agree that women should be aggressive.
I don't have no experience I want to talk about because my wife might be listening and I don't want to say.
Girl, it's in the past. Talk about it.
It was some aggressive things going on, though. I'm going to leave it at that. But okay. I backed off.
All right. So tell us about an experience where you've had a woman approach you like aggressively, where you were like, okay. Yeah.
It's been overseas. It was overseas where it happened to me. But like, I mean, this
Australia?
Girl. Nah, it wasn't Australia. Yeah, it was in the Caribbean.
You just told on yourself, Spence. Okay, but go on.
Totally put yourself out there, bro.
I'm just trying to say, Australia, you killed yourself.
Shout out to the Kevin Hart tours that take you all over the world.
Right? Right? He's never going to Australia again. Yeah, nah, but like, this girl, like, she straight up, like, I mean, just put her tongue in my mouth, and it was just violating. Like, it was like,
that was
yo.
How she walked up to you?
That was hello.
It was.
I keep trying to tell you my
the situation. Like, the situation was already like a very. It was a very
was
like
hot.
Yeah. Volatile. It was a lot of things going on. Like, it was a lot going on and all over the place.
Sounds like my type of party.
Was this like a visa?
About the,
nah, Spain? It was DR. It was DR.
Okay, yeah, it goes down.
Oh, DR.
It goes down in the DR.
I'm actually not. $25 a week.
I'm thinking of going to DR next week.
What?
I'm in Puerto Rico or DR. I'm going to one of those next week.
Oh, I'm so glad I'm not.
Now we
can
go to Cuba. So I need to go to Cuba.
Cuba is dope.
Yes, you do. Before the U.S.'s influence completely fucks it up. Yes, you need to go.
Go now. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, okay. What other reckless questions do you have for Laz? Melissa, you know him better than I do, so tell us some of his business.
Because I don't know any of her business. Because I don't know any of her business. And I would never tell it. And I would never tell it.
For those listening, that was a threat.
He does know a lot of my business.
Ah.
He does know a lot.
So you ain't curve everything, huh?
No, it's just.
Well, this is what Laz can do. Laz, during the break, tell me, and then I'll tell our listeners.
I know. I seen you try to get stuff out and it just ain't happening.
Yeah. No, it's I just like shut down like a, you know, guillotine and shit like that.
No, but I saw Laz once at the Culture Creators party and I walked up to him. We were talking. And he said, congrats on Love & Hip Hop. I was surprised you actually watched that show.
Laz loves that shit.
Shit is so ratchet.
He loves that shit. He does. I'll tell him.
Well, I will tell you that I will not disappoint you this season.
Really?
Oh, no.
Because you were on there last week,
I was on 3 episodes last season. I debuted last Monday, but I'm on 10 or 11 episodes this
season.
You kept
it clean last week, though.
Yeah, because it was
this is the beginning.
It was the beginning.
You were like the reporter, the blog.
I'm learning how to. Okay, my first episode, my first scene last season, my first time ever filming was the drink throwing scene. I mean, I wasn't comfortable on camera. I wasn't comfortable with the situation.
Laz knows that shit.
It was like some real.
Here's the thing. Like, I like to be able to just unwind and just watch. Just shit. Just is gonna entertain me. Like, I just make me laugh. Do some crazy shit, you know. And I enjoy it. I think it's like
you
good,
saw
like,
that scene, didn't you?
Yeah, I saw it.
It gave you a little bit of pleasure, didn't it?
I enjoy seeing all the ridiculousness.
When I saw Laz, I won't lie, I felt really embarrassed. Because, you know,
really?
You're fucking in white people movies. Like, you're fucking famous.
Bruh, but you know? I was proud of you because I remember when. Like, I remember when you were just, like, you know, struggling and, like, grinding.
I wasn't sleeping on couches struggling, but I was grinding.
No, but you were working hard. Yeah, like, you were still. Yeah. And, like, now, like, you got so many platforms that are popping. Yeah. You know, from the blog to the Instagram account that you finally got back.
Thank you very much.
You know, fucking this haters. And the show. It's like, you're hitting it on so many different paws. So many different mediums that it feels good. I love seeing people that I saw work.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, really get to. Yeah.
To actually see the fruits of their labor happen.
Yeah, actually, you know, when your friends start to recognize that and tell you, because you didn't know, I mean, you just congratulated me, but it felt good. You know, I saw Game last week. He said the same and got a call from a gangster today who's really big out there in the street. Shout out to WAC 100 who told me this. Somebody tried to make a call on me, but you can't do that.
We will talk about that at a later date.
But it's all good, but that person making the call, you better stop making them calls.
Ooh. Yeah.
But anyway, yeah,
that ain't good.
See, the thing about loving hip hop for me, I literally show up, I have a couple drinks, and I say, let's go. And I just do me and I leave, and I literally don't think about those people anymore, except for Nikki Baby, who's my friend.
Yeah.
Everybody else, like, you're my coworker. Like, I'm working with you, we're not going to hang out, never going to know where I live because you're going to make the call on me one day and then you're going to send them to my house.
Oh, wow, that's crazy, bro.
Yeah.
They're making calls off of loving hip hop.
Making calls off of loving hip hop.
It's business, it's entertainment.
Yeah, this season, I had to show a couple people that you just don't want to betray me.
Wow.
And so,
You don't. You definitely
don't. But I'm a loyal
don't.
Person. The thing about it is, you know, when you have friends like a Laz or a Floyd who are just literally living their truth in front of the world, they're just who they are, they're cool, they're just cool people. You don't ever have to worry about those people. But, you know, I'm not the type of person to befriend you, to betray you. In Hollywood, it's that, I don't know what it is where people do that to make moves, but.
It's an LA
But that's
thing.
Why you don't really have a lot of friends.
That's true.
In the business. It's I mean, most LA of thing. My friends are like, non-business people.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's just people that I came up with, grew up with.
And a lot of East Coasters, right? Because you're from D.C., you know, like, and what a lot of people don't know about you is the fact that you, at one point, were like, you know, you graduated from Howard University. Shout out to Howard University.
H.U.
Oh,
you know.
I love H.U. Exactly.
that was so Canadian.
Shut up. He always makes fucking fun of me.
You know Hollywood hilarious. Unlocked is H.U.?
Yeah.
A little synergy
going on. But you were also like in Wall Street. Like you were like basically like the equivalent of like a banker.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And you're literally sitting at your desk doing 90 hour a week, you know, work. And you're like, this can't be fucking life.
Absolutely.
So where did you go? How did you go from there to here?
Does it feel like you've lived like 5 lifetimes inside of one?
I have. But I feel like that's what I draw from when I bring characters to life.
Yeah.
Is I've done so much. Like, I've owned my own business.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Remy at one time was a client of mine.
Yeah. Mm.
Oh, wow.
You know, I actually pitched Remy back in the day and they were my client.
Yeah.
And now I'm a spokesperson for their, you know, for their new campaign. So it's all come full circle.
Commercials and YouTube.
Everything, you know.
I can't wait because
media,
you really translate well on TV.
Thank you. Thank you.
It makes me forget that he's my friend sometimes.
Actually, you know what? It's a great segue. It's a great segue because this man right here. the campaign that I'm a part of is actually called One Life, Live Them.
Right.
And it's exactly about that. I mean, I think everybody here has many lives. You know, you have one life, but you have many lives. You know, we're part of the Slash generation where you're an actor, host. You know, I'm going to be hosting, you know, the Verses and Flow.
Oh, yeah. I actually went to one of the Verses and Flow that you hosted. That shit is really dope.
Yep. Yeah. So
live music,
poetry. It's
like
just
they've had like Jasmine Sullivan. They've had like Faith Evans. I mean, it's really
all
and it's
unplugged.
Sexy.
Yeah. Maxwell.
It's sponsored by Lexus, I believe. Right?
Lexus, you know. Really nice. I was also a spokesperson for Lexus.
Yeah, he out here working. This is why I was nervous interviewing him. I'm like, has he seen this Reckless Ass show?
I love it. I love the show.
Then he came bringing drinks. He's so smart because he brought a drink. He's working with the damn drink. He's getting checks.
Damn right.
So for those aspiring to get into entertainment, like people ask me all the time, like, how did you get into it? I just created something that I was passionate about and I just kept working, and something happened. So how, for you, how did you go from Wall Street to here?
You know, that there really is no one formula.
Like, did you traditionally do acting school and all that? Or
no,
did
I didn't.
You didn't.
I didn't. I studied business at Howard. Because at the end of the day, you're really a businessman.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You're a businessman. You're a businesswoman. For me, when I talk to people, I tell them, study, you know, business, mm-hmm. marketing. This is what you need in this business.
Communication, networking.
Exactly. Yeah. Publicity. Like, yep. these are the things that you have to learn to be successful in this game.
Yep.
You know, everything else is a talent that you can sharpen. Like, I still, you know, I'll still take acting classes. Don't get me, don't get it twisted. I'll still, like, rehearse.
Or you work with a coach or...
Work with a coach before I have to go in for, you know, a big presentation, a big meeting, you know, a big audition. I mean, it depends on what it is and what project it is. But you know, it's almost like somebody like a Floyd.
Yep.
Like, I'm still impressed when I see this man, you know, or I talk to Melissa and she's like, yeah, I just went on a 30-mile bike ride with Floyd
Why haven't
Mayweather.
We invited Laz to hang out? Like, why haven't we?
I would totally go on a 30-mile bike ride with
yeah,
Floyd.
Yeah, no, well, I mean.
She's lying. Let me just tell you. I tried to impress Floyd one night. We at the house in Vegas. He's like, yo, let's go on a bike ride. He's like, yeah, let's go, bro. First of all, I have to stop thinking when Floyd wants to do anything that requires running, jumping, punching, jumping. Bro. So we get on this bike and the incline getting out of his compound was so rough. I'm panting like a fucking dog, sweating. He's like, you good? I'm like, I'm good. You know, she's in the Cadillac cart playing old R&B music with her sundress and a fucking hoodie riding alongside of us. And then the police are chasing us and we take a detour. And anyway, so Melissa does not ride the bike.
No, lies. That was in Vegas.
In the Cadillac cart.
No.
Okay,
that was
in Vegas. Okay.
You did ride a bike.
I did ride the bike.
For a half a mile at Venice Beach.
Bullshit. It was 6 miles.
Okay, last week it was 30, but 30
Shut
or
up,
6.
Both
it
of
don't
you.
Matter. It's fine.
We're getting to the... Okay, so we have to remember next time Floyd's in town, we got to get
Laz is totally invited. Yeah,
I'm down.
He's
but,
super
but
active.
My point for bringing that up was that somebody who is a world champion still trains like he's trying to be, like he's trying to win his first belt.
Mm.
And that's what it takes to like get to the top. That's what it takes to be the best at what you do.
I have one of his bracelets on right now. It says hard work and dedication. So when he used to say that, I just think about it, like you literally have to put in hard work and be dedicated to whatever it is.
It
and
doesn't
it's something
end.
That applies to everything.
It never ends. Yeah. It never ends. Like you really, you can't take anything for granted. Like you can't take your talent for granted because like hard work will beat talent any day of the week.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you're talented. You still gotta work like you're about to go broke. Like that's how I work.
Mm.
Like I'm one check away from being
broke. That Love and Hip Hop check came today. I'm still going to go cash it. And like a nigga, I'm going to go spend it all. Melissa, you said you had some questions.
I did. So we usually have guests up here, and the one thing that they do say, well, they say several things. They say, you know, it's really easy to talk to you guys. And I like that a little bit. But one thing that I really like is that our guests reveal things about themselves that not everybody knows. You are an HGTV fanatic.
Damn, I just lost all street credibility. Any credibility I had just went out the window.
Wait, what is HGTV?
Home and Garden Television.
Really?
Yeah, wow.
But here's how it translates, is he bought a house, a very, very beautiful house in the hills off, you know.
Don't tell them.
It ain't that beautiful.
Right. Very beautiful house. It was not beautiful to begin with. It was a shell. He gutted it and had it renovated, and it is stupendous. It is absolutely beautiful. He's extremely talented. If he wanted to become an interior designer or whatever, that could be his second gig in life.
Oh, so you was hands-on with it? You
yeah.
Was
very.
Wow. Yeah.
He's a control freak like Jason. There's no way that he was just like, okay, do this.
Aries.
That's a fire sign.
Yeah, Aries, Leo.
My man. Yes, sir.
There it is.
12th, brother.
Oh, you should have known. I should have known. I felt something great next to me. I just didn't know what it was.
Well, I won't say that I'm a control freak. I'm just heavily involved.
Right.
I like to be involved.
Okay. I'll say control.
While you're involved, are you speaking loudly about it?
Yes.
No, I'm Italian. I'm Italian. And this is what I always try to tell people. If you take my passion as anger or whatever, that's your bad.
Because
I'm Italian. My mother's Italian.
Yeah.
I'm Italian. So that's what it is.
So let me tell a really personal story about Laz, how it relates to me, right? So I went through a really horrible breakup.
Like, with Flo Rida?
No, motherfucker. Mention him one more motherfucking time.
Flo Rida.
Let's get this bottle out of here.
I just knew that was going to happen. Like, I don't even know why you said that, Melissa.
Okay, so here's a really personal story about me. I went through a horrible breakup. It was my ex-fiance. Found a tape of him fucking another bitch.
No, what was his name?
It doesn't even matter. He wasn't famous.
Okay. Yeah, let's make him famous. Hollywood Unlocked does that to people.
I remember those days.
His name was Alan. Okay. So anyways, I went through a horrible breakup. I went through a lot of traumatic things over the course of basically a summer. And I decided to come out to LA to basically see, you know, check out the lay of the land, just see if I wanted to move here and take some acting classes and basically vacate my life in New York City, mm-hmm. you know? And so I was like, Laz, I need to come stay with you. And he trepidatiously said, all right, fine. I got a second bedroom. You can have it. It's no problem. And what did you say after I left? You thought that I was going to be the messiest bitch. You thought that I was going to be like all over the place, you know, dating and hanging out and stuff. And I was.
Yeah, I just thought, you know, I really didn't know what to expect, you know, because I'm going to have somebody living in my place. You know, I thought she was going to be, you know, just a hot mess. But she was like. Cool. Like, I mean,
he's like a military guy, you know what I'm saying? So you could bounce a quarter off of his bed after he makes it. I was silent. I worked out like 3 to 4 hours a day every single day. And I went to my acting classes and I cried. That was basically my time in LA. And I was rough. Yeah, wow.
And he never hit it.
And he never hit it. No. Nah. He barely saw me. We were like two ships passing in the night.
I ain't gonna lie. When she first asked if she could stay with me, I kind of thought, but then when I saw the state she was in when she got here, I was like, all right, nah, it's hands off. Like,
yeah, damaged goods over here.
Not damaged, but you were going through it, and I respected that. Like, I was like, oh yeah, nah. That wouldn't even be right.
So
yeah.
you're in a couple movies with a really beautiful woman that I was that I'm a fan of, Paula Patton.
Super beautiful woman.
Love
so
Paula.
Are you friends with Paula Patton? Or are you just cool?
We're cool. We were much better. We were much closer during Jumping the Broom time. Yeah. But the thing is like, you know, when you're working with people for 3 to 4 month increments and you see them every single day, they become like a siloed family. Like mm-hmm. they become like an artificial family for mm-hmm. that period in time. And then you always have that kind of distant friendship or relationship. You know, even like with Megan, like I don't speak to Megan every day. Mm-hmm. But when I see her, it's almost like you can pick up where you left off mm-hmm. because you have to, as an actor, you have to develop trust with your castmates. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to develop a rapport for it to look natural on screen. Mm-hmm. It really has to happen. And so at the time, Paul and I were very, very cool. You know, she was obviously still with Robin. Mm-hmm. You know, she had just had her baby. So she was very, very focused on her family. Mm-hmm. And, you know, whatever she could give to the production, she gave. And it was, I personally, you know, thought it was a really good.
So I haven't seen her in a while, but the last few times that I've seen her showing up at awards, she looked a little out of it.
Last movie I saw her in was Baggage Claim. Was that the last project that she did that everybody knows about? Was there something after that?
Yeah, I mean, she's done a bunch of stuff.
Like, that's the last movie I remember her being in, like the last project. I can't think of anything that she's done since. No shade. I love her.
She's a great actor. Yeah.
She just did that Warcraft movie. You know?
Oh, I didn't see that. She was in that.
Oh, she was in that.
So is she just naturally kooky or do you think she's on the coco?
That's what rumors say.
I mean,
rumors
I was trying to think
says.
Of how to
you
ask the question.
I've heard that.
Wow.
I mean, she was. I mean, the BET Awards. When she got up there, I was embarrassed for her.
Hold on, is she half black and half white?
I think so.
I'm half black and half white. I am too.
And that's what I attributed her kookiness to. Was okay. That's the Becky in her.
So what do you think?
Because that's
at the time when we were cool, she wasn't. I honestly don't know what she's doing right now. But at the time, she was cool.
She was cool.
Yeah. But she had just given birth. Like, she had just had her baby.
Well, hopefully she's okay. Because I like Paula Patton, and I would never trash her name. I just always had the question.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I liked working with Paula because she was, like, a thinker. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, even with the baby, like, I'd get an email at 3 in the morning, and I was writing her an email at 3 in the morning about the next day's worth of scenes. Like, mm-hmm. yo, I just went through these scenes. I like these lines, but I don't like these. Do you mind? What do you think about if we just said this? And she would be sending me the same email I like working with people that are thinkers, and like there are certain actors that basically just take whatever's in the script and regurgitate it on screen. To me, I don't really see that as acting. Mm-hmm. I see that as memorization.
I was just going to ask that question because I text Queen Latifah jokingly that I got bit by the acting bug only because I'm trying to get a check because she does all these damn films.
Right.
But really, is it hard to remember all your lines? Like, how do you remember all these lines for all these different scenes? Or do you do it? How do you do it?
You don't have to memorize the entire script. Just memorize what you're going to shoot for that day or that week.
Okay.
What you do have to remember is your character arc, like the journey that your character is going on, mm-hmm. so that you know exactly where he is at that point in the mm-hmm. script, because mm-hmm. you shoot it out of sequence.
Mm.
You shoot a film based on locations, mm. not the order.
And then
of
they
the film.
Piece it together.
And then they piece it together. They edit it together. So you might, you know, like for example, Jump in the Broom.
Mm-hmm.
Paula and I's first scene of the film that we shot was the end of the movie when we get back together again on the bridge.
And you haven't even gone through the journey.
We haven't even gone through the journey, and we barely have really even like spoken or developed a rapport because she had her baby. So we couldn't talk. We couldn't go to dinner. Nothing that would at least break the ice.
Right.
And so it was
that
tough.
That must have been awkward as
shit. It was awkward, you know. And then like, you know, you don't know, like as a man, you know, you got to warm your way into like a kissing scene or a passionate scene. You don't want the person to think you're being gratuitous and like, oh, let me get this quick little, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So you want them to still mm-hmm. think that you're being professional, but you want it to appear real on screen. You want people to really believe what they're watching. So like the first few takes, you know, I guess they weren't that good. Tracy Edmonds pulled me aside and she said, look, man, she was like, you're kissing her like it's your sister. He said, I don't like what I'm seeing right now. This was Tracy.
Well, shit, you didn't know her.
I didn't know her. Right. You know, and I'm looking at her as like the new mom.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Hey, well, nice to meet you. How's the baby?
Like, yeah. Right. You know, so I had to switch gears and I had to get into that, like, you know, I just got my girl back. Like, my girl left me and I just got her back. And then I had to relive that moment and go through times when, you know, I've been cheated on and broken up and I got my girl back and all this other stuff. And then finally, like, we really got in that zone and the proof is in the pudding.
Mm.
But, you
I would
know,
love to act opposite you, Laz.
I think
you just
want
him
dope.
To put his tongue in your mouth.
Maybe.
Oh,
I'm not. See now.
See, that's the champagne talking.
Damn.
No. So this is what I've been doing wrong.
Here, Melissa.
No, Laz, this is just something. Up. She said something to make you be like, okay, Laz, right. Then boom.
Laz. A little known fact.
My dumb ass was falling for it again. It never fails.
A little known
fact. Never fails.
A little known fact about me. I've been known to get niggas pussy.
Bruh,
yes, Melissa, yes, he does.
Melissa's a tease, though, man. You can't believe all that. She's acting right now. That was all. She,
well, no. let her work her way halfway through this Remy bottle. You'll be getting a phone call tonight.
Okay, so for all the way over there now, foot right here.
So for all the, it's the cocoa butter that made it slide across.
Cocoa.
The so okay, so shout out to Paula Patton. So. Okay, real quick. So for the women out there, not including Melissa, who has your phone number, for women that don't know you that may want to fuck you, what do they have to do? What does it take to get Laz Alonso?
Yeah, Laz, are you in a relationship
no,
right
wait,
now?
You can't ask.
Sorry.
How you going to ask a question? Well, I need to, the viewers want to know. I don't care, but the
well,
viewers
if he's in a relationship, he's not going to entertain the question.
He can entertain
doesn't
the question.
Doesn't matter. He's fulfilling his radio duty.
Stop. He's like ratings over relationships.
Stop cock blocking.
Sorry.
Shit.
What do they have to do? I mean,
what's your type? Like, what would he like?
Well,
no,
you know,
that's
you
not the question.
Okay,
stop
sorry.
Giving
okay.
him a fucking
okay.
out.
Sorry.
I want to know. Okay. The viewers want to know.
What do they have to do?
I put Laz Alonso was here today on my Facebook, and these bitches are going crazy.
Yes.
So
yes.
I got to cater to
I
them.
That.
You know, okay, so, I mean, basically, you don't really have to do much. You know what I'm saying? Like, I like to be the doer.
To be the chaser.
I like to be the chaser.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I like to hunt.
I do too.
I think that's, you know, why I really like being in the room with all of you, because I'm like surrounded by like testosterone. And I'm just like doing the backstroke in it. It's awesome. Lady.
Like, your question is a great question. Like, you know, like I could be like, okay, all you got to do is DM me. And,
not like you didn't just say it.
Right. But I mean, it's a lie. Like, at the end of the day, like, I like to hunt. You know what I'm saying?
Like, you like a little chase. You like
I
a
like
little,
to chase. And I'm going to tell you, like, honestly, like, I mean, we're in a different era now where if you're a hunter, you're considered thirsty.
Yeah.
That's not how I grew up. Like, even if you weren't hunting, like, if you weren't necessarily trying to holler, But if there's a beautiful woman, you just give her a compliment. Yeah. You say good morning. You say hello. Like, you'd let her know that she's hot.
I just went on a whole rant on my Snapchat where I was saying, stop getting confused thinking that you motherfuckers that can't even pay a phone bill are worth the hunt. It's the chase that is enticing.
No doubt.
And you know, you can flirt.
Needless to say, my phone hasn't rang since that rant. But
right. It'll start ringing again.
It was the truth.
But you can flirt without being thirsty.
Yeah,
like,
I agree.
Why does flirting take such a negative connotation? Like, why does that automatically make you thirsty?
That's that new generation.
But, yeah, I mean, maybe I just don't get it.
That's the new generation.
You know, but to me, it's like the way I was raised as a man, you're supposed to compliment women. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to, like, let a woman know if she looks good.
You look very nice today, Melissa.
You look beautiful.
You look amazing, Melissa.
You look like you look like you're ready to get drunk and go fuck Laz today.
Wow.
I would say this is one of those. This is one of those.
Hey, you got to see Laz's response. Wow.
Bruh, I'm just being quiet. I like him, man. I'm like, shit, listen, we need to hang out more often. Like, this motherfucker does all the work.
Jason, didn't I tell you that was going to be the end result?
When she told me, I said, are you sure? Laz, she was like, reckless. I was like,
y'all would be really good friends.
The only thing is, if you fuck tonight, we talking about it next week.
Right.
Oh, God, I can't
now. Gotta do my push-ups.
That's okay. Right. This is one activity where you could lay on your back. Actually, she said she likes missionary position over everything else.
Yeah. You did say that.
So you got to have
I do, too, though.
Oh, so there's compatibility.
Let me tell you something. Missionary position gets such a bad rap. Like, everybody talks about missionary as if it were boring. But missionary, if you think about it, like, the woman...
Very intimate.
Yeah. And the woman is literally opening her legs and inviting you in. Like, it's
really
an invitation. But you know what I'm saying?
She's receiving you.
She's welcoming you.
For the record, I don't know what you're saying, but I get the visual.
You know what I'm saying, right?
No, I understand the connection. I get it.
It's an embrace.
A woman hasn't invited me in between her legs, thank God, for a long time. I stay in my lane. I'm not a drunk driver. I stay in my lane.
But go to a flashback to what he's saying. That's what he's saying. Flashback.
I went through therapy. I blocked a lot of shit out of my childhood. See how the show starts to turn around the 11th hour.
I don't even think we could go anywhere after that.
I know. I'm about to lose all my sponsorships, all my deals.
The views expressed on this show have nothing to do with Laz Alonso.
Right. They're not views expressed by me. They're views expressed by Hollywood.
Yeah, we just dragged them to hell with us.
So, Melissa, I can't remember which one of our interviews. I don't know if it was with Floyd, but you said you... Did you say you don't shave, right?
What?
Did you say you didn't shave?
No, I never said that. Well, I get lasered.
Oh, Giovanni had said that he was going to shoot the laser guy who was going to shave you the day that
you weren't.
Because
he likes 70s pussy.
Yeah.
He bow chicken wow wow.
Oh, he like hairy.
He does.
So is that your
thing? That's his fetish.
Nah, I'm not into hair. Yeah.
So he knows the girl's coming out the laser place like you.
Basically.
So you see, I'm just trying to figure out other.
You gotta remember, like, brokering. I'm like very like, okay, so yeah, let me shut up because you're brokering.
No, I'm not
gonna fuck it up.
Yeah.
Keep talking, bro.
No.
I have nothing to add to this conversation. I'm just gonna stand here and let you do all the work.
Watch this. Melissa, have another sip.
Are my eyes glassy?
Absolutely. And your lip gloss is popping. Shout out to Lil Mama.
Okay.
You know what Lil Mama looks like?
Oh, God. Listen, I said we're going to...
Laz says she was very black and white on that interview. You said that. Right?
Can you imagine him with a glass of champagne? Oh my God!
You know, sometimes
it can get ugly when I drink.
You know, sometimes I sit in the show and I go, "Did we really have a good show?" But now when I look at the table, there's a ball gag, there's alcohol, there's the hairy vagina. Like
this shit is like, yeah.
And we cover politics. So are you into philanthropy?
Hilarious, but I am actually.
I can tell you.
I love to give back, but I feel like amount of money.
Shut the fuck up, Jason.
Sorry. Seriously, we're talking about charity right now. And no, we're not talking about your vagina.
Laz, philanthropy, focus.
I feel like
somebody's watching me.
Oh man, yo, I'm sweating right now.
Just like fan yourself.
So, like, I feel like everybody should have a mission statement. Like, I feel like everybody should. Like, what's your mission, Jason? What's your mission?
To get you some pussy.
Laz just threw the oop on that. That was a nice oop, Laz. I like that. What's your mission, Jay? That was a nice oop right there.
If we were standing up, we'd have the chest bump. No, that was a layup. No. That was a alley oop. No. Boom. Yeah. Last Kobe person. The Shaq. That was Kobe the Shaq.
Okay, look.
So back to philanthropy.
Yes.
You know, I feel like God's overall mission that he gave me for coming on this earth is to inspire others. First of all, I don't feel like I can inspire others unless I am walking what I preach. And, you know, what I preach is that you can accomplish anything you put your mind to. And you know, for somebody who's first generation, you know what I'm saying, American family, came here with nothing, was raised with nothing. And you can accomplish whatever you put your mind to, whatever you work hard to. So that's my mission, and I live by that. And anybody that I can share that with and share that light, you know, especially the kids, that's what I'm here to do.
Jason, you know, and you are very similar in that way as well, amongst a whole bunch of other shit.
Yeah, but I started a foundation called the I'm Ready Foundation, partnered with Trayvon Martin's mom when he died, because I was just so inspired by it. I mean, I was a gunshot victim. My brother had been murdered, and then him getting killed. And it's funny that you're talking about our tagline was inspiring change through culture. I really feel like a lot of kids, especially kids of color, aren't really exposed to the opportunity. I mean, they see it. You see it on TV or you hear about it, but you're not really exposed to it. I mean, when we did our first event, it was like 700 kids, and they were just like in tears because I had brought all these folks from Hollywood that they see on TV and stuff, but they didn't feel like they could get to these people to talk to them about their dreams.
Exactly.
It's crazy, but it's amazing when you see people who've, quote, made it, still understand the responsibility of reaching back.
So. We have to reach back because... when we do reach back, we don't know, even if we touch one person, we don't know how many people that person is going to touch and how many lives that person is going to save and change. And even if it's that one person who, you know, might have at one point considered doing something, and because of something that I said, now they're like, you know what? I'm not going to take the quick money. I'm going to wait. I'm going to grind. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to work hard. But, you know, like all the people that I grew up with that were doing shit when I was a teenager, they're all either dead. And I know everybody says, oh, they're dead or in jail. But, you know, that shit is true. That shit is real. Yeah. Yeah. Like, motherfuckers was selling drugs for rims.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? For, you know, and now it's like they're broke. They're old and they're broke. Or they're dead. You know what I'm saying? Because their best years of their life. Yeah, I mean, if you go to jail, the best years of your life, you're going to miss them. You're going to lose them.
Right.
Let's not glorify jail. No offense, no disrespect to anybody that has already gone through that in their life.
Right.
But for those that have not gone through that in their life, I'm not going to glorify it because, first of all, the years that you spent in jail, now you're wasting them. You're making money for somebody else. Because these private prisons are making a lot of money off you being in that on that cot.
And if you would have stayed focused, your contribution that God had for you to this world would have been so much more impactful than sitting in a cell.
And like I said, I'm not gonna hate those, because there are a lot of people that ain't had no business going to jail. But because it's a for commerce industry, they're getting sent in like it's no tomorrow.
Right.
You know, so I'm not. But at the same time, I'm not going to glorify it either, because it's not something that you should feel like it adds to your credibility. No, that time that you would be in jail, you could be working. You could be, you know, building a business. You could be working your way to being the next billionaire. You know what I'm saying?
Well, thank you, Laz, for coming on the show and having the courage to sit here with us and allow us to try to ruin your brand. But and thank you for talking about reaching back. And hopefully tonight, after a few more drinks, Melissa let you reach around.
Reach around.
That should be a song. Reach your brand.
Go fuck yourself, Jason.
I might try to do that.
Yeah. No, thank you all for listening to Hollywood Unlocked Uncensored.
Melissa, you always had like a little pool party at the house, so you might as well invite everybody.
Yeah, why don't you two? Yeah. Why don't we all say we're going and just let them two show?
Why don't you all shut the fuck up, all right?
Well, here's the ball gag.
Shout out to Volt Energy, by the way. Volt Energy.
Yes.
Shout out to Volt.
Shout out to them.
Yeah, thank you all for listening. Goodbye.
All right, ciao.